Danny boy. The pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the flowers are dying. It's you, must go.
Good afternoon, Paul. Thank you very much for inviting us along to your home and to your lofts today. Can you tell us what actually got you started in keeping pigeons?
I met a school friend, Jim Willis, and we started off catching pigeons with a bin lid, a stick, a piece of string, and bread. And after two or three days, we seen stray pigeons with rings on them. So we thought this would be phenomenal. We'll catch these racing pigeons. And this was the start of it. Unfortunately, I hadn't got a loft to put these strays in. So I borrowed, without permission, my grandmother's old meat larder. And it was a wire pan, wire box, on top of four legs. So I borrowed it without permission, took it home to the low road. My father came home from work and there was three strays in it. And he said he recognised the new loft from somewhere, of which I wouldn't tell him where it came from. And lo and behold, it was stole from my grandmother. And that was my first loft. I bred two young ones and I couldn't get rings. So I went round the local fanciers and Tom Marshall and a few fanciers from around where I live, and they started to give me some young ones. My father met the great legendary Harold Elliott of Lisburn, and our friendship started from there. I was introduced to Harold, become Harold's loft boy or loft manager, whatever you want to call it. I looked after some of the finest pigeons that ever was flew into Ireland, i.e. the 6 times France Cup, the 5 times France Cup, 2 Hall of Fame winners, 1 of Hall of Fame winners. I took out of the stock loft when it wasn't producing pigeons, and we started racing it at about 4-year-old. And it actually won the Hall of Fame after I took it out of the stock loft. We lost it going for the gold medal from the Sables. Then Harold built me a loft in the next door neighbour's garden, and I looked after it, and it was 40th Open Youngbird National to that loft. Then my grandmother died and my father built me my first new loft, which was 12x6. And that was the start of the obsession and the sleepless nights of Paul Swindell keeping racing pigeons.
Thanks, Paul. So what was your first big win?
My goodness, my first win, I won the Bude Smash, which was Oakhampton then, in Hill Street HPS. And after that, I won first open NIPA 29,000 birds from Dungarvan. And it was with a long-distance pigeon beating all the Bushards and John Sands and all the fancy breeds. The mother and father of it, the sire was 5 times France and the mother was 4 times France. 9 times France and they bred an NIPA open winner. So if you motivate them right and feed them right, you can win with long-distance pigeons will win sprint races. But it's very difficult to get sprint pigeons to win long-distance races.
So why did you actually concentrate onto racing national races, especially the French races? What appeals to you about it?
Well, the reason why I concentrated on long-distance races was Harold Elliott. He was my idol. He was a god to me. Clocking pigeons at 500 mile, Dinards and Mallow, you know, Rains, Hall of Fames we've got. It was just nothing else could compare to the buzz we got with it. You know, and with having a friend like that to start off with, what else could I do? And I've been obsessed with long-distance pigeon racing ever since. Now, I did diversify away to sprint middle-distance pigeons when I moved house and got married. But that interest only stayed for a short period of time. The buzz was good, but it wasn't the same as clocking them from France.
I know from talking to you before, you'd been out of pigeons for a while because you suffered from pigeon lung. What have you done with your new loft to make it more accessible and allow you to stay within the sport?
Well, pigeon lung hit me hard and it was caused by Widderhood racing. An enclosed loft with cobwebs in the ceiling, covered dripping with bloom, pigeon dust. Polycarbonate fronts, very little ventilation, and the dust and of many years of catching pigeons and getting out of the lofts put me on a hospital bed for 3 months a year. It put me in a house where I couldn't get to the front door. I couldn't breathe. It was unreal. I had to quit the sport on how to sell out. But my young daughter decided that she wanted back into pigeons and she's got older, and I says, look, we have to alter the lofts. So what we done was we built a 4 foot pit, we put wire grill floor on it. I was a farmer at that stage with pedigree Texel sheep, and I seen what we call farmer's tin. It's a ventilated tin. You can start off a 500 mil from the bottom and get your vent set into it to whatever height you want. So our loft was built with wire grill floors, wire ceilings, ventilated tin, which doesn't let drafts in. It draws in air. The sun warms up, heats up the tin. The tin stays lukewarm all through the night till the sun gets up at 5 o'clock in the morning. So you have ventilation, you have oxygenated air, which is warm to create form, and you don't have stuffy bloom. And your pigeons are immaculate because of the health factor of the oxygen and not too much bloom.
You specialised since you came back in the channel racing, and particularly the French racing, and you've had some fantastic results from it. How can you tell us a wee bit how you actually went about building up a family of pigeons, of your own pigeons, to race these races?
Well, first and foremost, what I did was I got in touch with the British Barcelona Club on Les Green, and I asked them for two names that they could give me that would sell me pigeons, because I wanted to fly with the Barcelona Club in Ireland the furthest distance that I could possibly do, because Barcelona in Ireland hasn't been flown for 60 years. And what happened was, I wasn't interested in particularly trying to win the King's Cup or the Friendship National or St. Malo. We just wanted to fly France, full stop. What we done was I rung them up and they said to me, there's two men I can give you numbers for. One is the famous Kenny Haynes, who was a legend and a lovely friend of mine. Unfortunately, he's passed away and he was sadly missed. And he would sell me pigeons. But he says the other man, Mr. Dave Goddard of Reading, would not sell you pigeons. It's just so hard to get pigeons off. So I had an easier task with Kenny Haynes and a very difficult task with Dave Goddard. So that was the start of it. I then travelled to Belgium and Holland in search of all the top pigeons. And I bought pigeons from certain fanciers at 600 mile. But 600 mile into Belgium, into Holland, is a 400 mile, 3,500 mile pigeons race into Ireland. So I went about it the wrong road. I brought these many pigeons home at great expense, and they failed miserably, couldn't get them home out of Bude. So I fell in with a gentleman who wrote a book, Long Distance Pigeons, a Mr. Clements. And Mr. Clements gave me a fancier away up and took the top end of Holland, who had a great hand, Barcelona Duvan, who was 4 times 846 mile. And I said to myself, here we go, there's the pigeon I want. So I bought two hens from this. I then decided to go around top Irish fanciers, i.e. David Black, who's a legend in the sport, who's won Hall of Fames and Fancier of the Year, and he had a phenomenal team of pigeons at that time, and I purchased some pigeons from him. They done very well. Unfortunately, they got too old and they're no longer here. Some of the blood runs through my family. Then I got pigeons from the famous Tom Marshall, who's been a personal friend of mine for guts of 40 years. And Tom Marshall's a legend. My goodness. If any man deserved to win the King's Cup, Tom Marshall deserved. He's been so many times second and third and so forth and so on. Then I bought pigeons of the famous Maguire, Malachy Maguire and Mark Maguire of Newry. And they have done exceptionally well. But the principal pigeons was Dave Goddard's. And I got Port of Ogie last pigeons through a gentleman in Port of Ogie. I bought his 4 times King's Cup hen, and she has left a legion of pigeons behind here. So basically, Holland and Belgium didn't do anything for me other than one fancier. Dave Goddard and Reading put me on the map. It was his pigeons that bred Queen of the Rain. Queen of the Rain was second open Friendship National. Joan was 27th open King's Cup after losing 15 minutes. He's bred me umpteen pigeons, which I can't even go through now, because in 20 French races, we have won 19 400 mile races in the club, 450 mile races in the club, and we've over 200 pigeons home out of the 20 French races. Now, not all clocked in race time. In the 3 days on 4th and 5th day, and by the way, boys, any pigeon that flies France on the 4th and 5th day is welcome here. I have a section left open 365 days of the year. So if anything comes back from France a week later, a month later, 6 months later, it's welcome at this loft. The two pigeons that was third, and fifth national for us, were late breeds. They were nowhere to be seen. They were clocked, but they're nowhere in the prizes. And in 2016, they're third and fifth national. 15 hours in the wing, 16 hours in the wing. So boys, don't condemn your pigeon that doesn't come on the fourth and fifth day, because you've no idea what happens to them. 500 mile is not round the corner from Loch Bricklin Lake, where many fanciers seem to think it is. Penzance pigeons are phenomenal, but that extra distance into France and the Irish Sea, not many will contend it.
You mentioned there about late breeds. Over the last lot of years, you've earned a reputation for getting fantastic results with late breeds, including, I believe, a late bred that flew from Poitiers in France at over 600 miles. Can you tell us what you're thinking is behind this approach? Because unlike a lot of people, you don't pair up too early in the season.
April, I pair up in April most years. Right, the reason behind the late breeds is I have 45 years of knowledge from many King's Cup winners, Derby winners, Hall of Fame winners, sprint men, middle distance men, champions of all denominations. Frankie Phillips, Hugh Phillips, Marshall, all the legends. But when we started back in 2010, I decided to cancel all that knowledge out of my head because it confuses you. And I decided I had a window business which was very busy, so I had to build a system to suit me. And I thought about it over the years. I want a pigeon full of 500 mile breeding that's young and dumb enough to keep going. A smart 2 or 3 year old pigeon, if he gets a northwest wind, especially out of France, he lay down and come back tomorrow and he land on your landing board and he say, look at me, I'm lovely, I'm home. He didn't put the work in. So I decided to breed late. Don't race the young'uns as babies. Let them grow out natural, get natural muscle, natural bone, get them to know they know my area far better than any 2 year old in most people's lives, because they're 24 hours a day on an open hole. They're out from 4 in the morning to 11 o'clock at night. So they're skating the country. My young ones or my late breeds would fly 2 1/4 hours when they're getting ready for France without touching the roof. Many's a man has come here and seen it. So I want stamina pigeons that are young and not smart enough to lay down, that'll keep going.
Well, we can see from the loft behind you that your birds are out to dance, and this is an absolutely beautiful day. But you're talking about young ones there. I'm sure it must give you great pride in looking at the performances and success of your children over the last three years. I believe they've won 5 RPRA awards between them.
Yes, they've won 5 RPR awards. First of all, it started off with Courtney. Courtney's a great stock child. When we had sheep, she used to go out at 10 o'clock at night and bring in 29 ewes in lamb. At 6 year old she was. Wasn't tall enough to look over the sheep. Then she went on to pigeons, and she's got an eye for a good pigeon. She puts the rings in the pigeons, does the stock. And she used to do all the scraping. She doesn't scrape anymore. But the boys come on now and they like the pigeons as well. The only thing is, when Adam was younger, Adam used to say to me, Paul, Daddy, there's an awful lot of pigeons running around with no tails and I don't know what happened to them. Well, I'm sure you boys could work out what happened to them. His wee hands was that small, he couldn't hold on to the pigeon. Well, now they've won 5 RP awards and they're strong.
How important do you think it is about getting children involved in keeping pigeons and racing pigeons?
Look, I come from housing estates many years ago, and all we done was fight all day, play football all day, argue all day. Many of us went and got drink as they got older and sitting on the side of the roads. When I was involved in pigeons, you're always at the back door. So I think it's very important to keep children out of trouble. If the organisations can create some place or some way to help young fanciers go forward and keep them in our sport, like the RPRA does a phenomenal job. They put these RP awards up, kids go to collect them, they put a great gala night on. It's important to keep children around their parents because there's so many bad things in the world today to distract them. I think it's important. But we need to do more for the children in the sport. And personally speaking, we don't do anywhere near enough.
I think that'll be echoed by a lot of people, so it would, that the children will be the future of the sports of the world. Talking about the future, what are your targets for the incoming season?
Very good. Well, contrary to people's opinion, we are only interested in French racing. And by the way, people say to me, your birds make it look easy. It's not easy. we want a pigeon for me, a pigeon for the children, on the landing board first. We don't care what position it's in, as long as we get them home. At the end of the day, it's more important to get them home than anything else. So we strive in breeding French pigeons. Now, we've took a new project on. We want to fly 700, 800, 1,000 miles from Barcelona. I know it's a big ask, but I believe with the right type of pigeon, small to medium, packed with performance pigeons over that tough Irish sea, there's a great chance that we could succeed to do it. And if you don't try it, you're never going to send, if you don't send your best and try it, you're never going to be a success. I need to get a pigeon out of Barcelona. That is my future. I'm not trying to win any particular race. I just want to see how far we can get pigeons to fly.
If you had one thing before you finish racing pigeons, if there was one thing that you could do and achieve in racing pigeons, what would it be?
Fly Barcelona, 1,000 miles.
As simple as that.
That's it all.
Thank you, Paul.
I'm not worried about the King's Cup or Quimper or St. Malo. They're all there for everybody to win, and there's many names on those trophies. But in 60 years, I don't think anybody has done it. The closest one, I got a late bred at 630 mile or whatever it was. But that's about the height of it. But definitely, I want to fly 1,000 mile if I can.
Paul, once you've got your actual pigeons to fly France, what do you then go about to actually build a family of pigeons to raise it consistently over the next lot of years?
Well, to totally honest with you, it's very, very, very difficult to breed French pigeons or any sort of winners. It's easy to race to win because you buy a DVD, two spoons, with a hood mix, depurative, train up the road. Basically, racing's easy. Racing's silver, breeding's gold. Most men find it very difficult to breed. Now, what I have done is, once I get my pigeons to fly France, I go to the pedigree. Plus, you have to get them from an honest man for a start, which is hard to do. So what happens is then, you try to line breed. And what I do is, I try to breed half brother, half sister, together. Because what I'm saying to you is, go to that other stage about the cocks. I breed a cock line. And I want to explain to you about breeding a cock line. So let's say you have an exceptional, we'll take it for a black cock or whatever the case may be, and he's exceptional. You pair that cock to four or five different hens, and you get your rounds of young ones. You test your young ones as yearlings until you get them to perform well, like IEU, the team of pigeons we have out of France. Then you do half brother and sister matings. So that means you're putting your predominant producer, which IE is the black cock, on both sides of the pedigree. So it's a son of the producer to the daughter of the producer to two unrelated hens, which is half brother, half sister mating. Then you must test, breed and test out to the distance you want to go to. Now, then you're bringing a cock line right down to four different hens, and you can also bring a hen line down to four different cocks. So let's say you had an exceptional hen, stock hen, producing the goods. Also breed her to four different cocks and pair those young ones together. That means you're breeding a separate cock family down, a separate hen family down, and in 10 years' time, which you don't need a cross for 10 years. I just can't stop buying top pigeons. It's just an obsession I have. If you want a third family, cross the cock and hen line together. Because if you breed young ones from the first mating, and that cock is a yearling for talk's sake, in 10 years' time, you're still in a first generation, and you've also bred six or seven generations from that. So you don't need to keep buying every year if you line breed to that point. Now, to produce better pigeons within the family, try to breed balanced pigeons, i.e. if you have a big cock pigeon, don't pair it to a big hen. Try to pair it to small to medium hen. You can't pair a Spitfire to a Boeing 707 and expect to get a smaller plane. One won't be balancing out the other. So try to breed small to medium pigeons. If you can get them single tail feather, the more the better. Now, for fanciers may not understand this, it took me a while to know as well. If you look at the tail feathers of your pigeon, the top tail, and you look along the quill, the left-hand side of it might be wider than the feather to the webbing to the right-hand side. What I tried to do, and it's only my own idea to help me get a balanced tail, if it's wider to the left, I'll pair it to a half-sister to that cock, which is wider to the right of the quill. And generally, they make them a balanced tail, which is even web on both sides of the tail. That cuts down your drag. That'll give you a better velocity. Instead of you being 150th and 200th, you could be 40th, 60th, 70th. And the more you test this out, you're going to get more balanced pigeons. And you're going to have higher velocities and better positions. That's just my idea of how to produce a family.
Thank you. From what you're saying, it's much more important for you than basically to look at the characteristics of the actual pigeons you've got rather than just what's on the pedigree, what's actually just the performance. You have to know what you're pairing together.
Yes, you have to. Look, if you get the pedigree right, people say pedigree can't fly, but a paper can't fly. No, it can't. And many years ago when I was a small boy, I put an advert in, which was the racing pigeon. And I advertised, wanted pedigrees of top national families, long-distance pigeons of all denominations, dead or alive. And an aged man phoned me up and he says, "Sir, young fella, do you want these pedigrees to sell young ones off? Dead pigeons?" I says, "No. A pedigree, sir, I want a pedigree. It tells the tale of line breeding, if you study the pedigree properly, of some of the greatest fanciers that ever flew into Britain. You can read a pedigree. I can read a pedigree like a book, and I can know whether they're doing half-brother or half-sister, how they're successful flyers. I.e. George Bush had done the three-point breeding system and become a legend. So I tried the line breed. I tried to be half-brother, half-sister. I tried to produce balanced pigeons with single tail feathers on small to medium.
Obviously, one of the things that's really, everybody basically gets hung up on it. Some people are great big exponents of it, and other people basically become totally confused about it, is icing. What would be your view on icing, and do you have any theories of your own?
I have my own theory about icing, but I want to talk about icing per se. Many years ago, I became an icing man, and I thought I was an expert. And it put me out of pigeons. It gave me many sleepless nights trying to work out the land sign, the quarter sign, the half sign, the standing sign. And I found out I was absolutely wasting my time with this makeshift icing in books. Now, my own personal opinion about icing, and I'm not going to talk about icing per se, we'll call it icing. It's my own theory. The circle around the pupil for the ordinary fancier, you must keep it intact. No spaces in it. From 12 o'clock to 3, a part of that circle is lost. You can't see with an imperfect eye. Nobody can do that. So this is where breeding comes into it. Most men just get, there's a lovely red cock and a blue hen will breed nice mealies. That's the failure on most men's breeding potential. So forget the eye sign, the land sign, the half sign, standard sign, racing green and all that nonsense. Pair dark eyes to light eyes. Keep the circle around the pupil closed, intact. And keep the irises strong if possible. Don't pair milky, washy-eyed, pearl-eyed pigeons together. That's okay in sprint pigeons, but in long-distance pigeons, I've found dark eyes because they're flying in the bright sunshine from 6:30 in the morning to 9 o'clock at night. And they're flying from France to Ireland, so they're facing the sun all the time. And that's why I like strong-eyed pigeons. And I have noticed over the years, most of the top long-distance pigeons are dark eyes. So try to keep your eyes dark. Try to keep the circle around the pupil intact. And don't get too hung up about icing because you'll get lost. You'll get that confused, you'll just say, sicken yourself. There's no need to be it. Get an icing glass and get your best pigeons, start to look at the eye and start to learn how to breed them. Because breeding's always gold. And don't go to too many icing books and get yourself confused. Dark eyes to light eyes, circle intact, keep your irises dark, and that's all you need to know. Pair your winners to winners. Now, people often say to me, winners to winners don't guarantee winners. Well, for years that wrecked me. I couldn't understand why winners to winners don't breed winners. Well, I know why they don't breed winners now, and I'm trying to help you if I can. If you take a big winner, and you pair till a bigger winner, and you want to fly France 500 mile, the pedigree might want it to flat, but his body chemistry isn't good enough to flat because it's too big. So a big winner tell a big winner to fly 500 mile, that's why they won't breed winners. So if you have a big sprint cock on a small distance hen and you think you're going to breed middle distance ones, It's not going to work. You need two generations before you can get it to confirmation size. So that's why winners to winners don't breed winners. But if you have a small to medium hen till a small to medium distance cock, both for the same job, your chances have improved by 90%.
Throughout the year, obviously, it's important then to make sure that the birds are being fed properly. Can you tell us a bit about the kind of mixtures and feeds that you would give the birds throughout the different stages of the year?
Well, we'll start off at the winter time, which is the most important time for me. Your races are won in the summertime, or flew in the summertime to win, but they're really won in the winter. I use heavy mixtures in the winter to fill the pigeons. So the pigeons are sitting on a perch. They're not trembling at night trying to keep warm. Their muscle tissue is full of glucose, full of energy, stored in the muscle for when they start to rear their young ones. After they get paired up, that's my stock loft. They're on heavy mixes, and they're heavy mixes right through until the breeding season's over. My racers, after February, go on a total winter mix. It's probably the most low energy mix that I could possibly buy. Not because of the cost. The simple reason is I want to keep the body fat out of my pigeons. I don't want them to get fat because they don't get trained here. They're only flew around the loft and they're sent to the third old board race. So that race on a low key mix is taking the body fat out of them. Now, if you eat steak every day of your life and somebody invited you out to dinner, you would ask for baked beans and toast because you get tired eating it. If you want to bring pigeons up till racing ability for the nationals, the week of Tilbany, I start dosing my pigeons for cocci, canker, worms, paratyphoid, they're injected for, and salmonella on paramyxo again. I put five hoppers in. I put breeding wean supreme in one hopper, beans, peas and tares, racing supreme, all sorts of mixes. So if it's a cold day and they're more hungry, they'll go to beans, peas and tares. I let them pick whatever they want because I'm trying to beef them up and make them feel epic for Tilbany, Bude, Penzance. They don't go to Penzance. After Penzance, I'm straight into France. So I want them to feel fantastically bloated, blew up, full of energy just for that 5 week period. So from February until the week of Tilbany, I want them low key, low energy, just flying home, not racing, because my racing's done in June.
Everybody is going on about these miracle potions and everything. In every shop and every store you go in, there's shelf upon shelf of products. What kind of medication and products do you use around your own loft?
Well, I use Fraser's. Neil Fraser's a gentleman. The whole family's been good to me for 17 years. I bought my sheep meal off them, my cattle meal off them. Their food's fantastic. Now, I get Fraser's energy mix and I put it in 2 half-hundred-weight bins and I cover that corn in Fraser's Glyco Plus, in Fraser's energy oil and wheat germ oil. And I put it in the sunroom and it bakes through the plastic with the sun so it soaks into the corn. I feed that late in the evening, getting ready for France, because the birds are on the perch, they're not flying all day, and that energy is being stored into the muscle. So I use all the oils, any oils that you can get. Peanut oil from Marks and Spencer's, cornflour oil from Marks and Spencer's. It's all energy. Keep it simple. Half these products is on the shelves just for the... It's like fly fishing. I've never seen orange flies in Ireland in my life, but they're all there for the fishermen. So what happens is you don't need half the products. You need a dose for canker, cocci, worms, paratyphoid, salmonella. We all know that. But every top fanciers drinker has got clean water in it until they're getting ready for their national race where they put multivitamins in. I use human grade because every single multivitamin is in molasses and it costs you £3 a tin, not £13 a bottle. I use high potency chicken minerals that grows chickens out naturally for human consumption. It's £4 or £5 a packet. It does about 250 litres. I try to keep it simple. I don't use all those other products because, personally speaking, I've bred the goods into the pigeons. I've never used them. My pigeons are flying well enough. So just keep it simple and cost effective. Buy better corn instead of better products.
At this time of the year, I use multivitamins, a chicken, heavy chicken multivitamins in the drinking water. Because these cocks have been all cleaned out for cocci, canker, worms. They've been done for paratyphoid, they've been done for salmonella and paramyxo. Every pigeon in this place gets done. But my stainless dog pens are so valuable to me, I can't afford to take chances. So, as I feed and water all these, they're all in heavy mixtures, they're on heavy multivitamins. So the nutrition is stored in the muscle, stored in the stock pigeon, until it starts to rear young ones. So it's not draining its body chemistry, feeding and watering young ones. In actual fact, this is extremely early for me to breed. I don't normally pair up until the first week in April, because our young ones are young for 6 months and I let them grow out naturally and I let the flan open hole. They're never trained, they're never raced from the come out of the nest until the following year. On the fourth race, on the Sunday after the third race is over, the yearlings go into the nest, go into the hamper for the first time in their life. And they're banging off the lids, they're not used to the hamper, they're not hamper trained. They get 5 tosses that week, the 40 mile. And on Friday, their first race is 164 mile, first jump. I lose very few young ones, which are now yearlings, because I let them grow out naturally. They're not flogged up and down the road twice a day, 40 mile tosses. Their wee muscles is growing, their bones is growing. I let them grow out naturally. The following year, as I say, the fourth old board race. The reason being is, I want my young ones going to France as yearlings and late breeds. I want them young, full of breeding and a bit stupid. And what I mean by a bit stupid is, they're having the sense like a 2-year-old to lie down on a northwest wind. I never train on a northwest wind or northeast because I want them to get a hard race on the day I want to clap them, when most pigeons are fed up being trained on and they're lying down on shop fronts, sea fronts, chip vans, restaurants. They don't want to face the Irish sea. I need my late breeds and young ones or yearlings to get up. Let's get home, boys. This is damn cold and damn tough, so that's the way I do it. It may be wrong in people's eyes, but we have got home received 229 pigeons to date out of 20 French races. And 80% of them have all been yearlings and late breeds. Most 2-year-olds that we have is either once or twice France. Sometimes I send them back twice in the 1 year. It depends how they look when they come out of the first St. Malo race. They might go back to King's Cup and Quimper. In 2015, between the two lofts, the children's lofts and myself, we clocked 60 in the 3 days in the 3 French races. In 2014, Jimmy Cullen, who's a legend and a lovely man, there was only Jimmy Cullen, myself and my daughter, and the whole of Ireland clapped in the 3 French races. It was such a hard year in 2014. So France is extremely difficult, and I don't want my pigeons punished by up the road twice a day as young ones, and 13 young bird races, up the road twice a day as yearlings, and maybe 16 old bird races, and they're expected to do every Ireland, Penzance, Bude, Tilbennies, Yearling National, Skibbereens, and then the men want to clap them 12 or 14, 16 hours in the wing out of France, and they wonder why they don't come. Most men would need them built in the shipyard. Unfortunately, the shipyard's closed, and I have to breed all my athletes to the sky here. So they get 3 up Ireland's as yearlings, Tilbenny, Tilbenny, and Bude, and they're never paired up to loft the fly France. They never see a cock, they never see a hen, except when they come home on a Saturday. That's the only time they see each other. Now, hens are flew for 2.25 hours in the morning, and if workload permits, the cocks are flew 2.25 hours in the evening. And they do it 2.25 hours, they never touch the roof once I get them on the system. That's why I don't need so many training tosses. The simple reason is, they're not getting flogged in cold winds. It's a pigeon's decision to fly around the loft into a cold wind. When he doesn't like it, he can alter his flight. But if you train them in a cold wind, you're forcing them to fly into a north wind or a northeast. And if he doesn't like it, and you keep training them in it, you keep racing them in it, he will eventually say to yourself, I'm not coming home here. Then you send it to Bude in a northwest, and you get a 10-hour fly, 7 to 10-hour fly. Well, you see the pigeon that you've abused from a baby, he won't flat. He just won't do it. So we try not to abuse them as young ones and go reasonably easy on them as yearlings. And then when they go to France, they have to fly it here. Every pigeon in this loft must fly France. It's not set up for the yearling national or Skibbereen or any other at this point. The children and me, we only fly France. And hopefully we're going to try and fly further. The furthest pigeon we've ever flown was Portiers with the British Barcelona club, which is about 600 odd miles. I don't know exactly what it is because it had to be remeasured. And we sent 24 to it. We sent 2 and 3 times France pigeons to it and late breeds. And we lost all the French pigeons because they were too smart. They'd maybe done 200 miles and they got down to St. Malo and they went, I know where we are. Another 438 miles to go in this cold wind. We got a late bred found in Wexford, reported in Wexford. We got a late bred reported in Cork Lighthouse by a fancier who said he would bring it up to the National Station. To this day, we've never seen it again. And we clapped one in the loft, and she was 9 months old and carrying one nest flight. 9 months. And she was clapped in the loft and at 600 some odd miles. She hadn't got the stupidity or the brains or whatever way you want to look at it to lie down. So that's how we breed them, whether it's right or whether it's wrong. And so far we've built our own wee system and it's been working.
Paul, can you tell us a little bit about the pigeon you have there now?
This is a blue cock. When the first year it went to France, it went as a late bred in 2015. And we clapped it as a late bred. And in 2016, we clapped it to be second section, third open, Irish Home and Union National Flying Club, St. Malo. Just under 15 hours. His father is a pigeon that we own called Golden Boy. Golden Boy has bred me 7 pigeons to fly France. He also bred a 3rd and 5th national winner as well. This pigeon's half brother was 3rd in the national as well, or 5th in the national in St. Malo as well. Its mother, the mother of this great cock, has bred 42 national prize winners. So she has from Penzance Youngbird National right through to France. And she's a phenomenal hen. I've made a large sum of money to buy her and I can't buy her. But she's getting old now. And our team this year in St. Malo was only 16 birds home in race time, 3 days, and we clapped 9 of them. And they're all raced as babies, or sorry, all raced as late breds in yearlings. And this cock is now twice France. It could be 3 times France, I never checked, because 2015 races were good racing days. And some of my pigeons were twice France in 1 year in the space of 10, 12 days. This checker cock is a pigeon called Extreme Heat. The day was 4th in the Friendship National. There was only 17 home. And the weather was so extreme, my daughter called it Extreme Heat. And actual fact, he was down for a drink because he had mud on his feet and they were dried. And he was beat by 13 minutes on an extreme hard day. His mother is a pigeon called the Duchess. And she's bred oceans of French pigeons here. Horner half-sister, or Howard half-sister, bred Queen of the Rain. It was second open Friendship National. There was only 7 home tonight, to which we had 2 of them. And she also bred a great hen called Joan. And Joan was 27th in the King's Cup after loss in half an hour. This cock is medium, the well-muscled, as nearly all our pigeons are. We're trying to breed them with single tail feathers, so that they're balanced. They're not sitting with a big wide tail like that, because that causes drag on a pigeon. So what we tend to do is breed them with single tail feathers so that they're streamlined and they're more part of the front of the pigeon. All our pigeons are like wee tennis balls. This cock has a good wing. He's not too big. The flights aren't too wide. A lot of sprint pigeons have very wide flights because they're looking to pull air to get faster ahead. French pigeons are looking the air to slipstream over the flights, not to catch the air, because they're going to have to fly for 17 hours in a wing in some of the extreme hard nationals. His father's called Policeman, and Policeman holds 5 first national French winners in his pedigree. 5 first opens, not 5 first clubs now, 5 first opens. The mother of this pigeon is the Duchy, and her mother was 6 times 630, 3 times 720, and 4 times 846 mile. from Barcelona. She came on the fourth Barcelona with dried blood on her wings, and her wing was broke. So obviously she's got extreme guts, and she's had to fly with, when the blood was hardened, she had been flying for some time with a bad wing, and that was her retired. This is a very famous pigeon around here, Mr. Goddard, Dave Goddard of Reading. Dave Goddard of Reading is a legend to me and many fanciers in the UK. He has won many awards, silver medals, bronze medals, gold medals, and Spanish diplomas, which is the equivalent of our Irish National Flying Club Hall of Fame. Only the father of this, the mother of this pigeon is the famous Sophie. Four times the money in Barcelona, and in her last four races, she only had one race per year, which was Barcelona and Palamas, 710 miles from Barcelona, 688 miles from Palamas. And she gets 12, 13 mile tosses, 160 miler, taking the Dave Goddard's work, and she must go to Barcelona. No races that year, lifted straight into it. This is her son, Mr. Goddard. He is the father of Queen of the Rain, second Friendship National, which was my fault. I had her lapped out. How she was going to open the trap and get in the Black Rain was beyond me, but she was second National anyway, of which we were second and 10th National. There was only seven home tonight, and we had two of them. This cock here has bred umpteen amount of French pigeons with about six or seven different hens. The Goddards is the best pigeons of my whole loft. They're phenomenal pigeons here. And the muscle is hanging off them. They're like rugby players. People may think they'd be sprinters, there's that much muscle on them. And as Dave Goddard told me, he says, Paul, you won't have to burn the tires of your car to get my pigeons from 600 miles. The muscle's already there. This is his wing. And again, he's a single tail fella. He's got a balanced tail. What I find is most single tail feathered pigeons have lovely round balanced muscles. For some reason, it must coincide with the muscle tissue and the balance of the tail that creates a balanced muscle. Now, the Dave Goddard pigeons would be old-fashioned English, nut brown eyes, not particularly fancy in eyesight, because I don't believe totally in eyesight. What I do believe is you must keep the circle around the pupil closed intact, because I personally feel it can't see properly if there's a broken in the circle of coloration around the pupil. That's the only thing I believe in eyesight. I don't believe all the hogwash about in a northwest wind it's going to do 1700 yards a minute with low flying cloud and small wires. That's a load of bump. I pair dark eyes to pearl eyes, light eyes, to try and keep the strength of the eye in the pigeon. This is only a theory on my behalf. I believe pigeons is flying from France to Ireland is flying into strong sunlight most of the time. So forget them to fly for 15 hours in the wing, they need a dark eye. This is what I'm finding. The pearl-eyed pigeons tend to go down. It's like myself, I have blue eyes, so I get sun blindness and sore heads because I'm looking in the sun too long. People with nut brown eyes can look into it a lot longer. It's only my theory, but it's working for me. Dark eyes to light eyes, keep the circle closed, and that's as far as eyesight goes, as far as I'm concerned. I used to believe in eyesight, and it put me out of pigeons many years ago. It put me mental, I couldn't understand a word of it. No matter how hard I tried, I couldn't get them home from Tilbany. So, that's my theory on the eyesight theory. This cock here has tremendous muscle tissue, a great wing. His pedigree is absolutely chock-a-block with 700 mile Barcelona pigeons. Every family of pigeons that I have paired the Goddards to has bred me French pigeons. It doesn't matter what strain. Tom Marshall's has been exceptional here for me. A couple of Davy Blacks has done well. They're no longer here, but some of the blood is still incorporated into the family. This is a new acquisition to the stock loft. This was bought at Matt Rakes' sale, Pied Beauty. It's a full brother of the famous Envy. It was first section, first open tarbs, third section, eighth open tarbs. She was sold to Blackpool this year for 4,500 sterling. I thought I would go to the sale and buy her with 1,500. I never even got a bid on. So I tried to buy many of her children, and they were all making between 15 and 2,000 pounds. But lucky enough, we were able to buy the full brother dandy, and it's this cock. He's small to medium, with a lovely balanced wing. He's a nut brown to gold eye, and he has the single tail feather, which we're all looking for in our stock loft for balance. He's round and corgi, and he's bred a few national prize winners. He'd be a big asset to this stock loft. We're hoping to pair him to a few select hens this year. The second acquisition, we bought a black pair at Matt Rakes' sale. This is the son of the famous Van Giel pair, and there's nearly 40 national prize winners all over Europe of the Van Giel pair. This is a full brother to the MPO national winner. We bought this pigeon on Matt Rakes' advice because as we're going to try to fly Aragusa this year, which is 950 miles to me, in the future we needed pigeons that's going to perform at that distance, which is going to be exceptional. So Matt, I phoned Matt up, Matt says, Paul, look at what you're trying to do. You must get some of the Van Giel pair. And this is the cock we bought, and we're exceptionally satisfied with the cock. He's small to medium, just like Indy's brother, Pied Beauty. And he's a nut brown to gold eye, which would suit us because we like them dark-eyed for 15 hours in the wing out of France. I think he'll be an exceptional pigeon for our project in the future. He's got nice, fine end flights, which we like on a distant pigeon, but they're not too wide and they're not catching too much air. He's small to medium, he's corky, he's not too long, he's not too big, and he's just nice and shallow, he's not deep. He's a typical long distant pigeon that we're looking for. And the famous Van Giel pair are exceptional pair of pigeons. I've seen the photographs of them, at one stage I'd like to own them, but they're too old now for me. And this cock is a beauty. And he's going to be paired to many different hens this year because we have to wait 2 years before we can test them at 700 miles. You can't send a pigeon to Barcelona or Aragosa unless it's 2 year old. So we're going to test them into our French races first. He's also got a single tail feather, so that means he's balanced muscle and everything's going for him. Just hoping he's good enough to fly into Ireland, and I believe he will be, because we're joining the Barcelona Club and the BICC to send in the future. Hopefully we can fly Barcelona or Saragossa, because it hasn't been flew in 60 years. And we're hoping to do it eventually. I don't know how we're going to succeed, but we're going to put our work in anyway. This is my very famous Queen of the Rain. She was second Open Friendship National 2012. She won the Gillydown Cup for the best hen pigeon performance over 400 miles in Britain. She won the RPROA 250 to 450 miles, Irish region. She is part of the two bird average winner in Crumper. There was only seven birds home in the night in Crumper in the whole of Ireland, of which we had two of them. She is dam and grand dam of many French pigeons already, and she's only 2011. She would be possibly one of the best hens ever to step foot in this loft. Her half-sister was 27th in the King's Cup as well. And Queen of the Rain has been paired to many different cocks now at the minute, and this year she'll go to four different cocks. And we have to keep pigeons over for stock because her children and her grandchildren are breeding national prize winners from France. She's small-bodied, corky, well-muscled, typical Dave Goddard pigeon. Her father is Mr. Goddard that was seen earlier on. She's a nice wing. She's nice and supple. She's four great dagger flights. She is single tail feathered. She's nicely balanced. She's lovely balanced, shallow keel. Her muscle is like a wee rubber ball. She's nut brown-eyed. And just generally all round, she's the perfect long distance pigeon for us. This is another very nice pigeon belonging to ourselves. This is Tough Lady, and believe me, she was tough. In 2014, there was only 11 pigeons home in 3 days from Crumper. This tough little lady was fourth open, carrying every single nest flight. She was bred in December, just before Christmas, before she came out of the nest. Her father is a very famous pigeon here called Blue Paul. He has bred a lot of national prize winners, and a lot of national French pigeons. Her mother is a pigeon called Blue Sapphire, who was bred by Tom Marshall, a full sister to Tom Marshall's fourth Open King's Cup winner. Blue Sapphire would be a sister, half-sister to 3 year-olds, four first East End Combine French Derby winners. She has bred French pigeons with every single cock pigeon she's been paired to here. This lady is a rubber ball. She's beautiful. She's a lovely distance wing, large four flights are daggered, plenty of spaces between them. She is exceptionally well muscled. She's a typical wee rubber ball. She's just a wee spar of a pigeon. She's not very big. And for the fly for 3 days, with only 11 home, and to fly in adverse weather conditions, you don't want them big. You want them small to medium. She has a lovely character. She's a lovely eye. She's well muscled, well balanced. And her first young ones are now breeders of French pigeons right away with different cocks. I sometimes paired to Extreme Heat, which was fourth national. So this hen's fourth national, Extreme Heat was fourth Friendship National. Queen of the Rain goes to Extreme Heat, it was second Friendship National. And then I take the young ones of these three pigeons, which is second national, fourth national, 3 years in a row. And I pair them together, and they are now breeding phenomenal pigeons as well. We haven't been out of the top four in the Friendship National in 3 years. The year that we're out of top four, we were 25th after losing 15 minutes in a fast race. So, for a hen that carried every nest flight at guts of only 7 to 9 months old, I think she was well named Tough Lily. Although this is a checker pied hen, another late bred. She is 2014. In 2015, she was trapped in France as a late bred. In 2016, she came here 26 seconds of 16 hours in the wing to be fifth open. Third section, fifth open, Irish Home and Union National Flying Club, St. Mullow. There was 16 boards home in the 3 days, me clocking in on the children and me. And the deal around here is, whoever clocks the first one, the other partnership must do the dishes for 3 days. I am still doing the dishes 3 years later. I have never beat the kids. This hen is small to medium. She would be a half sister to the pigeon who was third national. Second section, third national in the same race. And he was just under 15 hours in the wing. Her mother has bred me possibly 6 French pigeons. Daggered flights again. Nice and slim and pointed. Good spaces, good ventilation between the last four flights. Single tail again, only she's been in the bath this morning and she's a bit damp. She's apple bodied, she's got a good character, a good dark, rich, gold, nut brown eye. And I totally believe I will be pairing her to her half brother who was third national. So that would be a top mating for us. This year, us third and fifth national paired together. Then we have Extreme Heat, fourth national, Tough Lady, fourth national, Queen of the Rain, second national. They'll all be paired together. And Queen of the Rain will be going to sons and daughters of first and second King's Cup winners paired together, brothers of first King's Cup winners, so forth and so on. We have to always double up on top 10 performance pigeons in our start lot if we're going to get top results. I maintain, and it's only my opinion, if you breed of pigeons as 250th in the race and you pair the pigeons as 290th in the race, you're going to breed plotters. And in the modern day French race, no matter how hard it is, they're all the winning pigeons are always on time. And if you want to be in the top 50 in the French race, you must breed from pigeons that are top 50 position winners. I understand it's hard to buy those pigeons. As we well know, I've spent clean fortunes. Hopefully the kids will be old enough to go to work now and give me some money back, but I doubt it very much. But to buy the top, you must put your hand in your pocket, buy the best. Probably, you don't have to buy many. Our motto is we prefer to buy one for £500 than buy 10 for 50 quid. Because you're looking for a Walt Disney story. And you want to get the top of the table as often as you can, as quickly as possible, because years goes on. And if you get 3 hard French races and you don't time, you have to start again and again. So when we started back, we were determined to buy anything in the top 50. They must be in the top 50 in the French National, or we won't entertain them. This checker hen is called No Surprise, and she is No Surprise. Her mother is a daughter of Jim Donaldson's Reams girl, who's the longest flying gold cup winner. Four times the money in gold medal winner at over 600 mile. I think she went 3 first sections at 720 mile and 2 second sections at 650 mile. She was proud to her own son. That bred the mother of this hen. The black tip grizzle hen has bred umpteen French pigeons here with different cocks. Her father is a direct son of a Hall of Fame winner. And the Hall of Fame winner was a famous pigeon called Dolly. She was 4 times in the first 40 in France to win the Hall of Fame. Exceptional hen. Now, this hen was raised as a late bred, as a yearling late bred, sorry. She was 99th open St. Malo, then the hawk hit her. The following year, she was back on the road again. She was getting ready for France, and the peregrine hit her and tore her up. So she had to be retired that year. I put her on the road the following year, and she went to, where'd she go, King's Cup in 2014. There was only 36 pigeons home in 3 days, and we clocked her in the King's Cup. The following year, in 2015, I took my pigeons away down south to toss them along the coast, way, way, way down the north side of Wicklow Mountains. The peregrine hit me and drove my 7 French pigeons out to sea. 2 days later, I get a phone call from an old man in Wales. 4 of my French pigeons were sitting on his bungalow. He took a set of binoculars and a magnifying glass to get the telephone ring of one of the pigeons on the roof. He said the other 3 had red rings on them as well. And I can tell you what the other 3 were. The 4 times France cock, the 3 times France hen, this great hen, and the hen that was 4th open. The only pigeon I didn't get back that time was the 9th open, our Crumper National winner. It was the second partnership of the 2-bird average. Now, those 4 pigeons were sitting on a house in Wales, a wee cottage from Ireland, driven out to the sea, and those 4 pigeons returned back from France, or from Wales, and they're all my French pigeons. So we had to retire after that, because she's eventually going to get sick of seeing the peregrine and she won't come home. Our first 3 young'uns as yearlings have now flew France. She is also steak knife 4-inch lights, nice and thin and sharp, plenty of ventilation between them, and not too big and not too wide. You want the end flights nice and narrow. See them all 3 end flights? You want them like steak knives, so the air flows over the top of them and doesn't catch the air like a sprint pigeon with wide flights. She is also single tail feathered again. She's been in the bath. Nicely balanced on both sides of the quill. She has a good narrow back on her. She has a little rugby ball muzzle. She has another good dark eye. And she's not very big. She's actually less than medium now, even though she's 2011.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone and all the flowers are dying. It's you, must go and I must buy. But come ye back when summer's in the meadows, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. 'Tis I'll be here in sunshine or in shadows. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so. and all the flowers are dying, and I am dead, as dead I well may be. You'll come and find the place where I am lying. You'll kneel and say an ave there for me, and I shall hear though soft you tread above me, and o'er my grave shall warmer, sweeter be. For you will kneel and tell me that you love me, and I shall sleep in peace until you come to me.